I know that there are some people still coming. We had unfortunately another event that has run over a little bit in time, so that some people are still on their way, but I think we should not wait any longer. This university and even this room has over the years witnessed many presentations on collectivization. Very often in connection with the whole of the model, but also as part of agricultural policy, economic policy, social policy, social history. But I believe this will be the first time that we will be looking at the opposite side of the coin, and that is decollectivization. And oral history, those of us who have been involved in looking at oral evidence, oral history connected with the Holodomor, very often sigh with regret how late those efforts began, with memories faded and very many of the witnesses already gone. We are fortunate that in this instance, the process is recent enough that it could be studied with precision, with scholarly methodology developed even more recently. I'm very pleased that we have this opportunity to listen to remembering decollectivization and oral history. Our speaker is an old friend of the Institute, Natalia Fernandez-Friesen. If anyone hears me refer to her as Natalia Costa, it's only because of activistic recollections of the past. She has a very distinguished and lengthy resume, so I will only point out some highlights, starting with perhaps the most important, and that is in the years 1994 to 2001, she was lecturer at the Ukrainian Center School, teaching Ukrainian, and she did not leave it at that. She subsequently became, in 1998, the coordinator of the language program, responsible for all of the language training. And that not being enough, in 2001, she became director of the Ukrainian some program at Harvard. However, these are not her only claims to fame. She has done, you know, very important work, starting with her graduate school training. She has she actually has an undergraduate degree from Kyiv, but an MA and PhD in anthropology in modern languages and cultural studies, a joint degree from the University of Alberta, and she has progressed up the ladder from the lower to the highest rank of professor at the Department of Religion and Culture Anthropology Program at St. Thomas More College, and the Department of Archaeology and Anthropology at the University of Saskatchewan. There she also has conducted a great deal of work with, I'm not even going to talk about field work there, but in promotion of study abroad, she organized the University of Saskatchewan exchange program with Ukraine. I noticed that again, as proof of her good faith, she selected Ternopil in classical as the venue for that. I mean, every one of these items reinforces more and more, you know, her good judgment. She has a special interest in post-socialist transition, oral history, vernacular culture, folklore, diaspora, ethnicity, migration, and in terms of places, Ukraine, Eastern Europe, Canada, and specifically Western Canada. She has published numerous articles and edited collections. The edited collections bear such titles or subtitles as Oral History in Post-Socialist Times, Orality and Literacy, Oral History as Theory, Method, and Source, and monographs in Ukrainian, The Other World, or Ethnicity in Action, published in Kyiv, and then more recently from the University of Wisconsin Press, Ukrainian other lands, diaspora homeland, and folk imagination in the 20th century. This is about all I can do in the short time allotted to me, but we came here not to listen about Natalia, but to hear Natalia. So let me pass the baton and ask her to address this fascinating oral history project.
Thank you so much, Lipko, for this warm introduction. It's really indeed nice to be back in a very different capacity as a visiting fellow rather than a lecturer in Ukrainian studies, although I would take it back in too. Thank you so much for coming tonight. I also end with this introduction because he's already pointed out some of my identities which ultimately have informed the direction and the scope of the project which is going to be discussed today. And I have come to theory as a visiting fellow to work firstly on all this immense field data which was once collected and amassed in the course of the field work. And confess I'm early on in a stage where I'm just working around the conceptual framework. So my talk today is going to be rather somewhat disjointed. I will talk about the project itself, the historical context in which it evolves. I am an anthropologist, not a historian. I'm also contemplating and will be contemplating today, together with your co, on future applications of this work. I mean, if you have any suggestions, recommendations, some inspired comments in terms of how I can hopefully redirect my future monograph, I'll be very happy to consider those because I'm in that grateful moment of my writing, looking in different directions. So, as Lipko pointed out, decollectivization is a topic which has not been really addressed in Ukraine, specifically in some substantiated or engaged way by looking back at the process, the history that all decayed over the 90s and by crafting some sort of interpretational or an interpretational framework for understanding, for us to understand this period. As an anthropologist and also trained folklorist, I have come into this project, of course, from different angles of my work before. First of all, I was collaborating with William Noll, who has produced in the late 90s the first ever oral historical collection of interviews recorded with the villages concerning color segregation. That collection was published, and initially it was not received at all. It was just an obscure and solid publication, but only 20 years into its existence, that attention to that collection of my colleague, William Noll, have gradually gained its due respect. And following the steps of that project and many others, which eventually were set up and explored for optimization, and as someone who worked in many villages as field worker, albeit in different projects, I was always distracted by my folks, the people who I would work with, and they, instead of focusing on my whatever current project, I'd be focusing on, say, labor migration from Ukraine. I would be always distracted from these directions and pointed out to the conditions, situations, context in which, say, out migration, labor migration has been taking place in rural contexts. So there, as an outcome of these experiences, I finally decided it's time to actually look into the topic of what matters the most to those villages, the villages I've been working with. This is a bit of a preamble to what I and how I've come into this particular research. Let me see if it works. How do I turn this?
Error.
Okay, so I use the word decollectivization. In Ukraine, specifically, when I translated into Ukrainian decollectivization, that's a brand new term, which I believe I've introduced into the circulation. It's been now used. Borrow this particular term from a field of study, which can be indeed called decolonization studies. So, and I will return to that subtopic later. Let me first look back at that challenging decade of the 90s in which freshly, newly minted independent Ukrainian government and then subsequent governments following up in steps began looking into the agrarian reforms and more specifically into land reforms in Ukraine and attempting to also respond to the pressures of the international agencies which are respect and pushing Ukraine into modernize, to transform its collectivist culture to something else. When we speak about decollectivization in those terms, scholars point out two phases which that period of time throughout the 90s and a little bit early in 2000 had spanned. The first phase of decollectivization, quite outlined in all these bills, actually started even before the independence. Some decrees in bills were introduced by the late Soviet government with respect to the transformations in the agrarian sector. But the actual reform began obviously with independence. That you probably want to first piece with all the numerous bills which were issued and recommendations and directives which were to be tried to follow up. The first vision focused on the denationalization of land and then on redistribution of land but also collective farmers' assets to the so-called rightful holders of these future shares. This very first phase only initially identified that very process, but it didn't really resolve into any elaborate which would allow the villages to in fact own direct and come direct owners of the identity. Only later in the reform that began to be the case. And again, the reforms have continued. The first phase saw the demolition, or rather reorganization of existing collective farms, also state farm, collective agriculture. And in principle, not much has changed for the villages on the ground. They felt little change at a time. But it's with 1999 decree, which is, I think, mentioned more or less in the second slide, which is also known as the big ban of collectivization in Ukraine, this presidential bill of urgent mobilization of the organization of the agrarian sector had really was being, had introduced really rapid and quite dramatic changes in the legal sector, in the by following up these particular reforms. What I'd like to pay attention to is that very highlighted line that this particular decree stipulated that the reorganization of collective enterprises into private ones will be conducted within 4 months period. Within the first phase of the collective of collectivization, some 12,000 collective farms were reorganized or changed into something else. So with this particular decree, the rest of the country or collective or former collective farms currently something else in before they become fully privatized were subject to extreme dramatic rapid change. And this was of course followed up a little bit more on some other fronts with other bills and whatnot. But as anthropologists do, we take the perspective, we adopt the viewpoint, the ethnic perspective of the both three work voices, understand how these processes dictated from above would be received and lived through on the ground. And ultimately these experiences in the field, first myself as a field worker in the 90s, then eventually the coordinator of that process, exposed us to the ways that the villages themselves, the collective farmers, be they, you know, they have the collective farmers, be they the Chornogoboci, or the just workers, laborers, so to speak, how they have been dealing with processing and understanding these processes and living through them as such. The most important case here in Brussels was the one which resulted in indeed reassignment of the so-called land titles, the land papers or papers entitling the villages to owning an abstract piece of land. Finally, actually allowing each individual farmer to receive specific specific segment of the collective property, be it land itself or the assets as such. So that was also a very dramatic process. and I think I have it enough, but ultimately, if by 90 there were only 2.2 million landholders identified and recognized as such, within that short span of time, which lasted longer than 4 months, 6.8 million have been finally been able to lay their hand on these particular paille land shares as they were known in Ukraine. Currently, we have about 7 million certificate holders of the land in Ukraine. So it was a very, very rough change. Of course, as we may have followed the newspapers and maybe some policy analysis of that period of time, the transition from collectivized agriculture to something else that has been extremely dramatic. It's been quite a painful process with many outcomes. And more specifically, when I look at this particular cooperate with the word decollectivization, I don't really simply operate with this term as directing or describe economic infections. Rather, the word decolonization speaks for the entire complex of changes in sociocultural domain in the context of life worlds of individuals. And we, of course, when we describe this period, we oftentimes operate with terminologies, social rupture, historical breakdown. We talk about this juncture with, of course, decollectivization, dismantling of collective farms, and so on and so forth. And one of the reasons I was interested in this particular project was to try to figure out whether this would be the exclusively, the most legitimate approach for us to understand the processes of socialist transition and decollectivization. And that's where this scholarship on decollectivization studies is coming in. As I mentioned before, decollectivization studies, which focuses on the transition from socialist to post-socialist agricultural reforms, has been unfolding in Western scholarship, specifically in anthropology and sociology. And my colleagues in the field of anthropologists focused extensively on changes within property regimes, changes within property rights. Of course, a lot of attention has been paid on different modes of decollectivization. So in Ukraine, we talk about redistribution of property in other parts of Eastern Europe, Central Europe. Of course, we talk about restitution of property. That's a little bit inside the point. But it is also the anthropologists who are looking at these changes in the region, and amongst them, you probably remember very, very one of the anthropologists who spent a significant amount of time trying to decipher the complex period, Caroline Humphrey, but some of the anthropologists in the field have been also questioning that very assumption of complete counts, which had the village were describing to us in those interviews in the context of their lives in that particular period. And Caroline Humphrey, as well as Catherine Verdery later, both have been pointing out to some interesting similarities which have been observed by the scholars vis-a-vis the processes and changes were taking place in rural context where the collective farming was collapsing. Between that period of post-socialist transition and the period of feudalism. And because of these comparisons, which in terms of how the local suzerainties were evolving, how the local fiefdoms were organized, how the economies were transitioning from more or less regularized, centralized, of course, and central, into completely different barter-based economies. So these comparisons were drawn on the basis of transition in Russia, in some contexts in Poland. And interesting observation which I'm intrigued by was that while we indeed are talking about some chaotic, some, you know, some period of rapture, some period of dismantlement of life, not just livelihood, but the life worlds of individuals, we would be able to observe a certain logic in these processes. So we've had scholars internal processes of decolonization in different countries and trying to come up with some explanations why these processes unfolded in one way or the other. And such, and we have vacuum vis-a-vis the Ukrainian data or vis-a-vis the Ukrainian analysis. That's something that also I was hoping to do with my work. We should move to those slides though. So why again to focus on this particular project, apart from just my own personal interest and my own personal drive, as which I was pointing out to you. At the end of the by the end of the 20th century, by the beginning of 2000s, the Ukrainian demographic situation reminds us that the rural population, in fact, constitutes a significant segment of Ukrainians, about 32.3% of those living in Ukraine come from rural folks.